But if Clegg is able to push some of his policies forward in this coalition, and if we have a drop on Labour, do you foresee Labour to the darkness to the second party in UK? Is there a chance? And exceed the
on the first point, I don't think it's correct to say that, I mean, Gordon Brown was a more established figure.
More senior
than Blair. But what Blair had, and this became very evident in the press, was that he appeared English. Gordon Brown, Scottish, and Blair had, I think, much more senior. Much more appeal, voting appeal, in the part of the country that Labour knew it would have to win back if it was going to be in power again. So I think they were both reforming. They wanted to make something called New Labour, get rid of some of the traditional socialist ideological baggage. And it was agreed that Blair was the person best suited to do that. The rest of the SA's history. I think that's not quite what's going on in relation to Miliband. David Miliband, I think, does take us back to where the Labour Party was going. Because what New Labour was about, it seemed to me, was trying to distance itself from the trade unions, trying to make it appeal very much to the centre ground of British politics, and we were very shocked. Miliband is trying to, I think, reclaim some of the Labour heartland, and has obviously come to that position, David Miliband, on the back of trade union support. So it is turning the clock back for the Labour Party. And I think there have been a lot of statements in the press and at the Labour Party conferences that what they're doing, what they are doing, is very New Labour. New Labour is as an idea and a coalition movement over. And it remains to be seen whether the rump of the Labour Party that is left, or the new disposition, will appeal to the British public. I don't think so, but we have to wait and see. On the Liberal Democrats, I think the fall in the polls is probably a combination of disillusion with what's happened.
By
forming the coalition. But there is this very interesting problem that the logic of everything that the Democrats, Liberal Democrats want is to be in government and in coalition. If they want a different electoral system, they want to participate as anything other than a minor party in opposition, then they have got to go into coalition. And therefore they've got to indulge in, engage in the kinds of compromises which many of their grassroots members don't like. And I think, going back to your earlier question, Chris, one of the things about coalitions and coalition behaviour is that it is a learning process. That, in a sense, you do have to know that you're going to have to give up perhaps some of your most cherished pulses in order to achieve something, to achieve government perhaps, or to achieve some policies. You may have to compromise on others. And that's quite a hard lesson to learn. People who go into politics because they like the purity of being Liberal Democrats or Conservatives or Labour supporters don't like that very much. I think behind your question about would the Dems become, could they become the second party of government, of the system, I don't know. The party almost overtook Labour in 1983. But it's possible. It's possible that this percentage is very, very volatile. It's possible that they could get a higher. It doesn't mean they're necessarily going to get a higher percentage of seats. But yes, it is possible. I think. suspect they become much more active. The parties can move much closer together when it's specifically voted on, problem of the Liberal Democrats is keeping an identity for themselves, one in coalition, and one that they can then use to project to the public.
Time for one more question. I'm going to then, if I have any hands, I'm going to take the right of asking. Obviously, people in Kosovo are affected by British policies in limited but significant areas. British policy with regard to the expansion of the European Union, British policy with regard to foreign aid, security policy, perhaps at least in the sense that although Britain doesn't have a significant troop presence within NATO today, nevertheless, British first line reinforcements are there to cover the horizon to fly in if needed, if there was trouble or so. How would this Conservative Liberal Democratic coalition possibly change policies that could affect the rest of the world?
Well, let me take two points. I think the first point is about enlargement. Traditionally, the British approach to the EU has always been to be in favour of enlargement. Now, admittedly, that's because it makes it larger, the EU, the less likely it is to make meaningful changes to involve deeper integration. But I think that the British policy on enlargement is likely to be ultimately. I think William Hague, talking about this last night, is a very, very able foreign secretary, and I think that he is very engaged with
But Conservatives have historically been more pro-Serbian.
Was it Conservatives or was it the Foreign Office and the Conservative tendency to simply accept what the Foreign Office was doing? But I think there was a redefining moment when Blair and the humanitarian intervention doctrine came along. And I agree with you that people in the past may be more pro-Serb. But I think the world has changed. I think this Conservative government is certainly not going to be the proper change policy. It's very much a personal policy of Blair to push for military integration. Something that he makes quite a lot of in his book. I don't think that's been
Well, Gillian, thank you very much indeed for coming all this way and for sharing your
coming twice. the plane turned around.
Turn back, return you to London, and then put you on another